Welcome everybody to my Friday chess stream here on lichess and Twitch. International Master William Paschall. We're going to play some blitz and classical chess today, so hopefully we'll get some interesting games. If you'd like to play yourself against a challenge game against me, please make the challenge 5 to 8 minutes initial time with a small increment, preferably like 3 seconds or maximally 5 seconds for the faster time controls like 5 minute or 6 minute. We've got a number of challenges already. M47, the Booker Smith. It challenged me to Chess 960. We are willing to play a couple of Chess 960 games per stream, so maximum 2. Usually we play about 10 games on a stream, so 2 Chess 960s at the max. Good morning, Booker Smith. Calidus, Twitch has kind of changed. Twitch has changed its view. Things look a little different for me over here. But that's alright, we'll get used to it. I'll get used to it. You guys who are following from lichess may not even notice. Lonely Master and Calidus. So guys, we're gonna get started in a second. What's up? So the Tao Memorial continues in Russia. What am I gonna do today? My normal poker night has been canceled for this week, so I'm thinking of going to play in a rapid chess tournament this afternoon instead of playing poker tonight. Might be a new report of what happens in tonight's rapid tournament, but not very strong, unfortunately. Not a strong tournament. I might play. I haven't decided yet. All right, we're gonna go start off here with M47 playing 8-3. Fully awake today. E4, C4, D4. What do we want to play now? Start the game with a quiet English because early in the stream, I'm usually, I'm usually kind of groggy yet. Sorrenti, welcome. He says the first draw in the NLB in 11 years yesterday. That must have been a really extensive rain delay. I guess it's not a draw though. If it's canceled, if it's a rain delay. How does a draw happen in baseball? I haven't seen that story. Jeroen. C4, E5. Knight c3. Actually, against m47, we played, not against m47, against somebody else, we played the variation with bishop b4 yesterday. Not yesterday, the day before yesterday. I'm getting everything wrong. Booker Smith says, soup between, interesting. Yeah, how would a draw occur in baseball? I'm not really following how that happens. Didn't see that story. Pittsburgh, Chicago? Well, Chicago is like already cemented their playoff. I guess Pittsburgh's out of contention. F5 is an aggressive move. It's very early here, though. You can also play it on move 2. That's even earlier. So this is debatable whether D4 is good. I always kind of liked it. We have Scandinavian style play. The f pawn, not really useful in the Scandinavian on f5. Often kind of a weakness. It's just a Scandinavian type of position where the queen comes out to d4, but we have played c4, so we have a bit of a English opening, Scandinavian sort of hybrid. Basically like a closed Sicilian where black exchanges on d4 or something like that. A rain delay, okay. I guess they just decided, anyway, the season's almost over, who cares? If it's a draw, no problem. It's kind of weird. How does that get scored, like, in the team's overall results and stuff? In a sport where draws aren't really possible, I'm not quite following. Alright, so here we have an interesting possibility now. Queen back to d1, of course, is fine. But we have also queen d3, queen d2, and queen e3 check. And queen e3 check, I think, is a move, like, normally after c4, e5. How would that go, actually? What am I talking about? It's in this position that it's played. It would be in this position that it's played. So this is a variation. Queen e3 check. I thought it was a different position, but it has to be this position. Queen e3 check. What's the point with queen e3 check? You might think, like, if bishop e7, maybe knight d5. What would be the point if knight e7 after queen check, knight e7? Black will try to fianchetto the bishop on g7 anyway. So, I'm not really sure about this. I think, yeah, well, no, it does have a point. I mean, you do... You just disrupt Black's development to some extent here. Alright, we'll try this. Knight e7 would prevent him from putting the knight on the better square on f6. So I kind of see the point with this. Only tangentially related. Did you ever hear the score of a game where one team scored against themselves? So they could tie and try for the double point? Overtime goal? The soccer game where one team scored against themselves so they could tie and try for the double point overtime goal. Completely invented on purpose. Okay, I don't know. I never heard about that. So bishop e7, and now that prevents him from putting the bishop on the better long diagonal, I guess. I just remember this is old variation was recommended to take with queen play queen e3 check, but it's not clear that it's that big a deal that black is in any difficulties here, really. We can play for the bishop pair and maybe a slight advantage. I remember years ago playing this line in Blitz against FIDE Master Charles Hertan. It's kind of weird to see Charlie playing this with Black. He was such a positional kind of player. It just seemed like he just did it in Blitz. He would never play a line like F5 in a long game. Nimzo Indian, connoisseur, and very strategic player. Didn't like to create weaknesses. Again, Blitz, he liked to play weird stuff. Thus f5, but now Black has a little problem. He can't play knight f6. I guess this bishop e7, interposement? What would you say? How do you call that? Interposement. Interposition. Thank you. Is not the best, because Black has no knight f6 here. This looks promising, obviously. And I'm going to try to play bishop e2. This was always the plan, basically. So I suppose the black's supposed to play another interposition on 5, e5, e7. Excuse me. Still, my brain isn't really working. Need another coffee. Elf will die. Knight d5, d6. Does anybody remember the very, very, very old video game called Gauntlet that was in arcades in the 80s? U.S. soccer? I want to say in soccer, the more points at the end of a season altogether is what they work toward. I'm not sure, though. Okay, so knight e5. Still not sure how black's going to really get out of this. I guess the plan is now c6, followed by developing the rest of their pieces. But the dark squares are really, really bad. So if you do want to play f5 with black against the English, I recommend you play knight c6 on move 1. It's a slightly more respected variation, though I don't think Black had to get himself into this kind of tangle here. Now, even the strange knight g4 has something going for it. But he'll have to guard the g7 on the next move. But there's something to that. I mean, maybe it's not so bad. So yesterday, apparently, Kramnik lost in the Tom Memorial against Pomniachtchi, and I didn't see the games. I did not see yesterday's games. That would give Pomniachtchi 2 wins and a draw out of 3 rounds. The other thing about it, this is a kind of question I just had about this Tom Memorial thing, is like, doesn't it seem like it would be more logical to have a Tom Memorial in Riga? I mean, does anybody know any kind of history with that? I mean, if you're going to have a memorial for Mikhail Tal tournament, is Moscow really the place to have that kind of tournament? I mean, wouldn't you have a tournament for someone in their home city, basically? But I guess it doesn't necessarily have to be. Obviously, Tal played for the Soviets throughout his career, but he was Latvian. And he was definitely from Riga. Sorochi says, I don't remember having seen her play Gauntlet. Just called Gauntlet. Maybe an American game. Now, it was much later than Donkey Kong. It was it was a multiplayer arcade game, which were pretty rare. You could play with, like, I don't know, 3 or 4 players maybe at the same time. It was kind of revolutionary. You had, like, characters, like, this fantasy characters like an elf and a warrior, and the elf always said, like, the elf will die or something if elf can't get food. It's just kind of it's an 80s thing, basically. I want to see if anybody was old enough here to even register that. Here, F4. Maybe F4 just wins by force. Let's see. Knight E3, knight F3 check. We just snap it with the queen. We're threatening to win a piece. Okay, it's not so simple, because if I do play F4, I create a pretty big weakness on E3. So let's say F4. Actually, F4, knight G6 is possible. F4, knight g6. I feel like it's a little anti-positional to play f4. This move, this knight f3 actually invites some kind of dangerous consequences. Maybe Black's threatening f4 in this position. I don't really want to give him time to develop, though. There's another argument for f4 by me. F4, knight g6. We could just play positionally. F4, knight g4. Queen takes queen check. Knight takes queen. Bishop takes g7. Rook g8. Then I'm going to, like, have to watch out for knight e3. Interesting. Our slight time advantage is kind of wasted here. And f4, is f4 a threat? Well, I could castle queenside, but... man, I want to play knight f3, just simply developing. If f4, queen d4, maybe. Queen c3. Alright, you can have your f4. I'll let you play f4. F4 by white just creates a lot of weaknesses in the position, and I think I'll either end up with a big weakness on e3 or problems with my f4 pawn falling. So we'll let him play f4 if he wants to. I think white should have clear advantage here, positionally. We're going to make him trade off this knight on e5, and he's going to have a static weakness on d6, a weakness on the long diagonal on g7. The f4 pawn may end up just falling. So instead he takes this way. Takes toward the center. So white has a pretty massive positional advantage. In fact, maybe d6 just falls. In this kind of position, just falls, I think. King f7, and I think he cannot defend. Cannot defend the d6 pawn. Not enough to win the game in itself, but it's a start. In and of itself, welcome everybody. Gladys Troll is here. The Gladys Troll friendly attitude. Yeah, he's always friendly, always nice. Nepomniachtchi. Quite the talented player. He is kind of Morozevich-ish dude. This is going to be a little bit problematic for me to convert this, I think. And I'm definitely regretting not castling queenside. Not the first time I've made that mistake in recent times. You wouldn't sack the exchange here? I don't think so. Perhaps we can like manually castle queenside with rook d2 and please exchange on d2 so my king can cross over the d-line. Assisted castling. It's like assisted living. Assisted castling. Please help me to castle. Mr. Opponent. Now a4 is worth considering, maybe bishop a3, and I'm going to get over here to the queen side. If I play a4, I'm creating some weaknesses in my own position. Try to activate all my pieces. Black has counterplay though. B5. Now I thought we'd try E4. Basically that amounts to like a pawn trade. I really need to open up the position for my bishops. We retain our extra pawn. Not sure. I have if rook a8, I had a3 there, which is okay. So rook to d1, is that a problem? Probably not. Very close to like self-mating myself here. good technique by Black. Ooh. So this is theoretically a draw. Very, very important position. With, oh man, I almost hung a pawn there. Rook h3, need to play. Probably getting kind of critical now. You had a much stronger move, rook h3, defending. It's possible this is still a draw. I'm not 100% sure. F6 starts to look pretty scary. Alright, tough to hold it in a limited amount of time, but that is a theoretical draw. The rook and bishop pawn. Definitely check that ending out in an endgame book and learn the defensive plan, because it's really pretty common. I mean, I think I've reached this ending probably like 10 times in my career from one side or the other. Once I managed to win it against a master strength player. Welcome everybody. So the original gauntlet machines on eBay from 1985. Soronchi is interested. pretty random thing to talk about. Chess, what notes post an interesting analysis of a recent Nepomniachtchi game from Natal? From the Tile Tournament. Yeah, Nepomniachtchi won two games already. I didn't see the yesterday's game. The yesterday's game. Apparently he beat Kramnik. Sparkle Horse versus Booker Smith. Booker Smith, thanks for the donation. Yesterday he made a donation to the stream, and I really appreciate everybody who's done so. Much thanks for that. So it's chess 960, guys. Everything looks good except for this rook on h, rook, knight on h1. Yeah, rooks are usually on h1. It's a knight. Let's get it in the center. You're going to try and use the green arrows. Well, that's my job. So I'm kind of analyzing the game. It's not necessary for you. Whew, it's a sharp move. Wow, f5. Just attacking a2 straight away, kind of. That would really open up the position. Let's go for it. This will be fun. All right. So my knight's in the game. He's got the x-ray attack. I don't know what you want to call it. It's not really an x-ray. It just sounds cool to say x-ray attack. Okay, so wide open situation here now. And fortunately, everything's protected for the time being. He's also hanging g7 and losing an exchange. That's pretty important. This is a pretty weird opening position. So he wins this pawn, but I win g7 and I win the rook on e8. It's probably decisive. I don't remember the last time we had like an open sequence where one side had a material advantage, a decisive material advantage. So quickly, yesterday I blundered my b2 pawn, also to a queen capture. Kind of hard to lose a pawn. Any other way, maybe a bishop, obviously. Cal, this is, should definitely look at that game. Quite interesting. Fortuit Follier, when you said CN posted an interesting analysis, what did you mean by CN? I think of Edward Winter's chess notes when I see CN. Oh, CN is the, oh my god, it's like the, it's Chess Network. Oh my god, I didn't know. The legendary Chess Network. I should have known. Man, why didn't that come to me right away? So c5, we're grabbing a whole rook here. Otherwise known as NN. No, just kidding. Knight takes e8. It's too much material, too quickly. Booker Smith, you don't have anywhere near compensation. What could you do there? You should go back with the queen and protect the rook. I mean, you have no other move. I mean, you have to go back here, and it's just an exchange. It's not necessarily the end of the world. Computer engines have played against Nakamura and other top players with handicap odds and beaten them. I know you're not a computer, but just to prove the point that that kind of material loss, like a pawn in the exchange, if you're stronger than the other player, you might be able to outplay them. Just for the sake of argument. Now here you lost the whole rook. You can still get it back, man. You have to try to get it back. What can you do? You can't afford to be down a whole rook here. You hate the scrambled chess. Well, just close your eyes and it'll be over soon. But I applaud Booker Smith. He's starting out and he's not afraid, you know, to lose here on the stream. And we don't want to like bully or criticize people who aren't as good as us. If you guys are like expert or master strength, some of us are not. You know, we all started. We weren't like hatched from chess eggs, you know, and we were like master strength when we were born. Let's not pretend that's true, you know. So everybody has to start somewhere. I know a lot of more arrogant players would like to pretend that they were always 2200 or a candidate masters, but it wasn't the case. And I applaud anybody who's under like 1800 willing to play here on the stream and not, you know, embarrassed to lose a game. Same goes for Troll. Troll is mostly in trouble on the clock, but he still, you know, goes out there and tries every time. So, not to be bullied by the naysayers who are results oriented. Queen f7, that's probably the best move. I think it's the right idea. You gotta get that piece back. I mean, one thing to be down the exchange, but it's not that much that it's like automatically game over. Don't listen to what the other people say, because I've definitely screwed up with more material advantage than this. This is a really strange move I just played. I don't know what I'm doing. g3, what kind of move is that? Seriously. I was going to develop my queen to g2. f3 would be a better move. It's hands down. Although I will need to get this bishop. This is such a bad move. Okay, I gave you kind of handicap playing this just totally inane move, g3. I'll just pretend I played it to, you know, play. Support the f-pawn and play queen takes c5 check. You've only moved your knight. You're up 6 points of material. I can't believe I'm up that much. I'm up a pawn and an exchange. It should be like maximum 3 points of material. Well, after my last two moves, it's probably dropped massively. g3 was just a waste of time. So, good move. Though he is blocking... he's blocking his other bishop. That's a serious problem. So... I've got no development here. This is really insane. Okay, no development at all. There were supposedly 3 decisive games from a news story I saw yesterday in the Tom Memorial. Didn't see what the others were. Anybody want to let me know? Jeroen, did you see? So Nepomniachtchi rising to the occasion with two wins. He's +2. Kramnik should be. See, draw, loss. Kramnik didn't win a game, did he? But anyway. Thinking about going to a rapid chess tournament today at the first Saturday tournament series here in Budapest, although I don't think it's going to be very strong, so I'm having second thoughts about it. The chess tournament series here in Hungary and in Budapest has moved to a new hotel, to a new location. It's a little bit away from the center, so it's not really optimal. A lot of people are going to be turned off by that. B3. This is a double purpose, developing a piece, hitting the knight, and also supporting this outpost square on c4. We could castle. I don't see any need to castle in this kind of position. The rook is actually potentially active, like down the a file. So maybe I don't really want to castle. I want to use that open file for the rook. Kramnik lost to Nepomniachtchi, right? No, I was just thinking about Kramnik's overall score. Tomaszewski and poor Gelfand. Mamedyarov won. So Mamedyarov won again. He's a very aggressive player, sometimes too much so. Like against Anand the other day. Nagiri won, so he'll silence his criticizers. Really, it was too much of this Giri draw. He just had a lot of draws in one tournament. I give him a break, you know. It's one tournament. I mean, enough. Enough said. The guy's a great player. He's not drawing every single game like Peter Lako because he just doesn't want to play anymore. That's a different story. So here, we're on this guy on b6. There was an article in Chess Base about Judith Polgar, or Judith Polgar, Judith. You know, how she retired from chess in Tromso 2014. You know what? And she was like the coach for the Hungarian team, supposedly, this year. The Hungarian team did the worst, like, it's ever done in recent years. That's not exactly something to be proud of. And just retiring from chess. It's not like it's baseball or something where your body has to, like, you know, be in youth like condition. I mean, it's kind of weird. The whole concept for me of Polgar retiring. I mean, okay, she's just chasing money, basically. I think she wants to make money. Kind of like Susan Polgar did very early on. Loses a queen. Anyway, it's lost position, so we're not going to go down the take back road here. I just don't understand this retiring when you're like 40 years old or less than 40 years old. What is that? You know, seriously. I'm taking a year off because she had a child or something, but it's very strange. I mean, really very strange to me. You know, you're not a true chess player if you retire when you're like 40 years old. I couldn't imagine it, you know. It's just hard to understand. Kalidas. So we're playing against Kalidas here. Yeah, 4-2 at Folio. Yeah, there was a lot of people who were making fun of Giri. Of course, you know, mostly trolls, but it started to be a kind of internet meme, you know, this Giri draws all his games, but he's. That happens sometimes with solid players. It's not unusual to have a round robin tournament where one player may draw every single game for whatever reason. If they're just unbeatable and they're not getting the position they want. Kramnik also has a kind of predisposition to that kind of result from time to time because he's very solid. But I didn't understand his game against Li Chao from the day before. It was just totally insipid. Like a player who didn't want to play that day, basically. Okay, the Slav defense, the ever wonderful Slav defense. I played a lot of games with Queen C2. I don't think it's objectively dangerous for Black. We've kind of learned that, but it's still a good line. It's a solid way to play. But I'm going to play the main line, Knight C3. Is 42 old enough for a real chess player to retire? I don't see how, you know. I don't understand. Actually, Polgar's sister, Susan Polgar, quote unquote, kind of retired when she was in her 30s. I mean, she just wants to make a business out of chess and so doesn't want to play, just wants to concentrate just on making money, just on making chess into a business. And you know, for me, that's sort of cheap. I mean, I don't know, you know, just to try to only focus on making profit from chess is never really respect that. I mean, yeah, I can ask for donations to help support the stream, but I'm never gonna stop being a chess player. I'm never gonna stop competing, and I don't know. I just love playing chess. Seems like a true chess player would never stop playing. You know, look at Kasparov stopped because he was. It's one thing when you're like world champion. I mean, and you realize that you're going downhill, and everybody wants to like take it away from you. I kind of empathize with Kasparov, quote unquote, retiring. Because once you've been at the pinnacle, there's nowhere else to go, you know. But other players, it's hard to understand this. Polgar's too young to retire from playing. It's obviously financial. But Bishop G5 here, the sharpest move available to white. I think the Hungarian team needs a new coach, though. They finished like 15th, and there's lots of strong players in this country, so it's absolutely disgraceful result. And you can't put it all on Rapport for losing some games on board one, although that's an important factor. I don't think it's fair to make those judgments. You don't necessarily know their personal situation, and the game of chess can really mess with a person's mind. Well, we don't have perfect information, of course, but I do live in Hungary. I know a bit about the Polgar, so. H6, bishop takes F6. Yeah, we'll never know. It's never fair to make judgments about, well, we're like pundits. I mean, we're not judging them for eternity. We're just making a comment. It's strange to retire at 40. I mean, it's not baseball that you're, or soccer that your body doesn't work anymore. I think that people, you know, should keep playing. I mean, I really respect the people that do. You know, we'll phrase it a different way. I really respect the players that keep playing and really love chess. You know, quitting at 35 or 40. If you're a top player, it's strange. It's one thing if you're like me and maybe couldn't make a living and you had to quit because you needed to put bread on the table. That's a different story. But if you're like one of the best players in the world and like a Leko or a Polgar and stop playing, yeah, of course, they might have a mental problem or it's too much stress. There's a lot of reasons you can quit. I'm not condemning them for it. I'm just saying I don't think, you know, you should under normal circumstances. Nobody's condemning them as bad human beings, or it's a judgment against their soul. I'm just saying it's weird to quit chess when you're 40. That's as deep as it goes. I mean, I don't understand. Booker Smith says, I'm wondering, am I bothering people when I play? Because I know most people come here for strong games. Yeah, Booker Smith, I mean, that's not the way it was meant to be, you know. A lot of people will troll and say, oh, why is this guy who's, you know, not as strong as the rest of them playing or something, you know? Doesn't necessarily work like that. It kind of happened that a lot of strong players sort of gravitated toward my stream. But I never set out to make it just for a certain strength of players. You're welcome to challenge me, as everybody's welcome to challenge me. I don't know, you know. I have a personal thing against people kind of, how to say, trying to turn chess into just about trying, just a business trying to make money. We all have to make a living somehow, I understand. And maybe I'm not as focused on, financial benefit from chess as a lot of people. But for me, the chess is more about the game than about turning into a business. If I wanted to do something to make a lot of money, I would have gone to school for law or financial economics or something like that and gone into becoming a bond trader or something. I mean, I wouldn't become a chess player, so it's kind of strange. It seems like if you choose chess, you choose it because you love it, and then to change midstream. A lot of players have quit chess, though. That's another thing. It happens. And not staying in chess. I mean, leaving chess altogether is a very, very common theme. Polgar is one of those people who's gonna like stay inside chess, like her sister, but not competitively play. This is the model that Susan Polgar created for her, basically. I think a lot of players have just quit cold turkey and gone into jobs in financial markets and banking sector, especially a lot of other things. I can just name endless grandmasters who quit the game. One who comes to mind sometimes is the other Jeroen. Jeroen Piket, whatever happened to him? He was like a top 10, practically top 10 player, Jeroen, your namesake. When you think of talented players who just like dropped off the chess radar completely, I think Piquet is probably one of the most talented of those. He's a guy who would still probably be on the Dutch Olympiad team if he was still playing chess. So it just kind of hurts me to see great chess players. And plus it's my age is in that same range with the Kramnik, and I'm a little bit older than Polgar. That's another weird thing. To hear about someone younger than you retiring from chess is kind of disturbing, I think. It's sort of disturbing me somehow deeply psychologically. That's why I'm so passionate about it. What made you come back to chess from poker? Well, there's a number of factors. Number one, I mean the poker, online poker is kind of died relative to how it was, and the other thing is that I just miss chess, and it's a much deeper thing for me. So I still have hopes to attain the GM title if I can afford it and play enough in the next 5 to 7 years. I think there's still hope. I could improve by 100 rating points or so. It's still theoretically possible, so there's still hope. I thought, well, if I'm going to come back to chess, I need to do it. I can't wait any longer, basically. I spent basically 6 years away from the game competitively, playing 9 or 10 games a year. There was one tournament in 2011. I didn't realize that. I was saying in June that I hadn't played a tournament in like 5 years. I guess it was exactly 5 years. Before I played in June, the last tournament was 5 years. So basically 5 years. If I wait any longer, it's really too late. I was also commenting on Anand's opinion about the fact that 40 is the new 50 or whatever, and I don't really buy it. I think Anand's making excuses, basically. So Kramnik proved him wrong. I think the Kramnik just works a little harder than Anand. Anand was a huge and is a huge talent, and you have to take that into consideration. Some players are just more natural talent and less hard work, and I think that's the case with Anand. He's so naturally talented that F4 here. This is not so clear, actually. F4 is a creative move. I'm not so sure what's going on. Maybe I don't have that much here. Calidus gonna win your pawns back. Pawn takes pawn. There's also bishop c4 check, doesn't really do anything. But I just realized something. Instead of that, we have another move here. Instead of f4, we have another move. The main concept of this whole combination is the fact that his queen is pinned to his knight and he can't defend it. So I can just bring another guy over with rook e1. Maybe the other rook is better. I'm not sure. It might well be the f rook is better than the e rook. Let's do this. Yeah, Piquet lives in Monaco, working as a personal secretary of some Dutch chess. Oh, he's the personal secretary for Joep van Ostrom. Oh my god. That's even weird in a way. I mean, that is weird, you know? I mean, to stay that close to chess and not play. Wow, I didn't realize that. That is a bizarre job to have for such a massive chess player. He's the personal secretary. Shit. That's crazy. Wow. All right. And we just seal the queen off here. That's why I said the rook, the other rook, might be better on e1. To actually, ironically, defend the a2 pawn. But white is better now. I have a monstrously strong protected passed pawn on e5. Does becoming an IM give you earning potential beyond tournaments? Or is it really just personal achievement? Yeah, I think it does. A lot of people try to make it a lot of people try to make the IM title into a full-time job, and that's kind of what I'm doing now. I mean, if you consider teaching lessons and doing the live stream and stuff. But I don't make enough money. I don't think I can make enough money that most people would be really satisfied with that as a career by today's financial standards. Kind of living to a large degree on my previous earnings, savings, and seeing where I end up. Good game. Fortuit Follier. Saddest Troll is late today. Saddest Troll, you challenging me to raid it? He's behaved himself. I mean, we had a joke yesterday about rated or non-rated. No, I think the non-rated is more consistent. But I didn't mean to be angry with you, Troll, for fighting for your right to play rated games. Piquet play Halifman in Groningen at the European Youth Championship. He was such a great player. Yeah. So many strong players have quit. Knight f3. I thought we'd mix in some flank openings. I didn't get my second coffee yet, so I'm still not that sharp. Though I enjoyed that position, that was fun. Rook e1, kind of unusual tactic. I've never done something like that. Exact tactic where you let them capture a piece and pin them along the e-file in one of those Slav-type positions before. Kind of an original idea. Guys, don't forget to check out my YouTube channel, Video Chess Training on YouTube. I'm going to try to do different stuff over the course of the year. Whether it's doing standalone lectures about openings and strategy, or just uploading my streams. The other day I did a review of the Wednesday stream, so we can also do reviews of live streams. Maybe analysis of games we played here with you guys or other players online. Everything is possible. Check it out and subscribe to my channel. D takes c4 now, and this is... bad memories coming back to me. I think I played a game in this Vienna variation a while ago here on the stream and lost pretty badly to somebody. This is one of the sharper openings in the queen pawn spectrum, and one of our own Hungarian grandmasters, I'm an adopted Hungarian player now, Zoltán Ribley is actually a big expert in the Vienna variation. He's used it extensively as a defense for black. Now black played c6, so that takes it into a different realm. You really need to play sharply there with either, okay, b5, some kind of weird Queen's Gambit accepted type move. Either bishop b4 or c5, basically, in this position, I think are necessary. So, 4-2 at full eight, just play c6. This basically lands you in a passive Slav type position, I want to say, which isn't really correct. You're not getting enough here. You're just giving me the center, and you don't really have any counterplay. I mean, you could say it's a little like a Marin with like b5, b4, but it's not, because I've got a very aggressively placed pawn on e4. In the Marin, my pawn would be on e3 in this type of position, so I'm much better placed than a typical Marin. Asphyxius, just want to say I've been enjoying your stream. I've been watching for the last few days. I really want to learn more about chess, but I don't really know where to begin. It's a daunting task to work on. Are there any books you suggest to start with or anything? Yeah, that's a tough call. If you're just starting out, like, what should you study? Good question. I've always kind of believed in the classics, but I rarely get asked this. What absolute first book should we start with? Or any means of learning the game? I really learned very classically with kind of old treatises on chess, old by my standards. Not like, from the last 18th century or something, but the classics. One book I recommend, but it's kind of just games, not really. I don't know what I want to do here. Wait a minute now. This is sharp move c5, and he doesn't have much development. I'm not sure if I should play d5 or e5. I recommend a lot of classic books. 500 Master Games of Chess by Tartakover. The most instructive games of chess ever played by Chernev. Those are some really good books for beginners. But the Master Games of Chess is more like just for everybody. It's not necessarily meant as just for beginners or for advanced players. It's a collection of the most instructive games of chess. My System by Nimzowitsch. There are a lot of classic books. I mean, I really don't think that I would recommend Chess for Dummies or some kind of very modern approach. I like the classics, honestly. Not to take anything away from Jim Eade, but he's not really like a classic chess trainer. I like the old school approach, so I would recommend classical books. Nimzowitsch's My System, 500 Master Games of Chess, and the most instructive games of chess ever played. Any of the old classic books by like Dover Publishing on chess are very good. It's like a discount publishing house that published a lot of old chess books for very cheap paperback form. Those Dover books are very good for the most part. There's a few that aren't that good, but those I would recommend. Now we have some attacking chances here on the king side. I thought we'd just go direct with like knight g5, but it may not be enough if I play knight to g5. This feels a little bit artificial. Knight g5, g6, and then what do I do? Is kind of a problem. So let's try to think about this. Knight takes d4 may drop a pawn on e5. So rook d1 is an idea. Speaking of Nimzowitsch, this is kind of a Nimzowitsch type of position where we maintain the strong point on e5 and blockade the pawn on d4. Nimzowitsch did similar things in the French. Yeah, so old school classic books, I would really recommend. Of course, you want to get these books in like algebraic notation if it's possible. The older copies have like figuring descriptive notation. So that's not really a place you want to go, because if you get the old notation, you'll start reading that and then not learn to read like algebraic chess notation. B6, and that makes learning more difficult. Having to learn like two kinds of chess notation. So if you want to get like one book, the most instructive games of chess ever played by Chernev is probably not a bad place to start. More digestible than the others, maybe. B6. Taking the pawn at d4 now, still not great because of knight here. I want to attack on the king side. How about knight g5 now? Is it any better? Could we sacrifice on e6 in some lines? Really? So knight to g5, g6. He could even play h6 in that position, actually. No, h6. H6 maybe not so good. G6. I could play knight to g3. Feels very passive to play this move. Something like a3 is slow, letting black get kind of developed. We have sometimes ideas of playing knight g5 and knight h5, excuse me, and this move. Just played g6. Unprovoked. Okay, now this is defended. I mean, that's kind of one of the main ideas here, but we also have bishop h6. Developing this piece. Though I think the black's position is still okay. Sacking the exchange. Sometimes people kind of panic. I mean, I think this is a panic move. Not necessary, I think, to sacrifice the exchange there. So we are glad to accept. There is this thing about knight f4, though. Before to Effolier, not using too much time here. So he's making me work. When did you first become international master? Well, I got the title back in 1999, finally. Made a lot of good results between 1996 and 1998. And then finally they applied for the title in 1999. But I think I reached my peak later. In 2001, 2002, and came to Hungary to play as much chess as I could. Started on that project, but then I got kind of distracted by playing poker. So I ended up torn between these two games and finding it difficult to do both. I mean, I don't know how a Simon Agdestein or whatever can play professional soccer and professional, or how he did professional football and professional chess. I can't really think about two different games. I kind of do one or the other, and my focus has always been kind of one dimensional on one thing. I really put my energy into one thing, or I put it into another thing, but it's very hard for me to go between the two, in the same day or in the same week or the same month. I just kind of really get into one thing, and so we did 5 years of poker and was fairly successful with that. But in the end, I think the poker trend sort of dying, and there was a fantastic period for poker, but although I still like the game, it's not easy anymore. All right, what do we do now? Black has some good counterplay here. He has very good compensation. Powerfully placed pieces. Bishop a6, bishop f8 is potential, has a lot of potential. Rook takes d5 allows bishop b7, which makes it a little awkward for me. Maybe I have to do it. Pawn is a pawn, it's an important pawn. Obviously. But I think that Black has good chances to hold this because he has a monstrous bishop pair. He's down a pawn and the exchange right now, but the pieces and the structure are pretty good. And he obviously has more time. So we have to consider the practical aspect of time. I don't know if I'd want to do this if I were Black in a long game. I guess a computer for white could play this position near perfectly and just refute Black's sacrifice, but it's not so easy. So now we see Rook d8 as a possibility to force an exchange of rooks. Or rook e1. Kind of a tough call. These rooks in the center files should really reach their kind of maximum value in such a position. So my extra exchange should really matter. Exchange, rook for knight or rook for bishop in this case should really be relevant. I mean, these rooks have as much power as you can get with those two open files. And now their knight, okay, queen f6, knight e4 takes f3, takes c5. Kind of a technical ending where it could be tough to win for me. Terrible blunder. Queen f4 would blunder the exchange and could just equalize on the spot. It's a bit of an awkward move. We only have 3 second increments and it's not easy to gain time. With like 5 seconds, I could kind of make quick moves and gain time on the clock. I find that's difficult to do with 3 second increments. I'm not really a mouse-oriented blitz player, as you guys know. We have another plan here. We have another plan here. Wow, Bishop H6. Looks like a blunder. Kind of a blunder by Black. Blunder by me. Blunder by me. Nice going. So you get a exchange back for a pawn. I'm on the seventh. Ooh, this is a really technical position. I really thought this knight looks kind of lost. Maybe not. Rook on the seventh, pretty deadly. Rook b7 was possible there. I'm not a big fan of knight endings, and this move isn't good. Knight on the side. Very much doubt that's your best move. Now what? Good D, except for knight a4. I don't understand that. Putting the knight on the side there, you had probably better squares. Wow, man. Fortuitfully, I wasn't really sure where you were from. You're from the USA, okay. A rook check takes. You're not giving me any time to do anything. That's kind of tough. Does not give me any time. And we do have a powerful passed pawn. Two of them. I don't think we need two on the f-file. One is enough. He's exchanging. Alright. Gotta get the king in the game. Creates a kind of force field. Can't cross over there. Don't really know where to play there. With the a-pawns, this a-pawns situation, not really sure. It's not so easy to make progress here. Maybe I should go up. Can't go up. Just chase the knight away from the center, I guess. This is close. I'm not sure I'm winning. I'm up a pawn, but it's a doubled pawn. Two doubled pawns. He resigned? You resigned? What happened? Black resigned. Why would you resign here? It's not clearly lost. I don't think it's clearly lost because the extra pawns, there are two doubled pawns in the f-file. They're both rook pawns on the board, which are notoriously bad with knights. And both kind of have drawish tendencies. I'm not sure this 100% is lost for black. But you would think being down two pawns and a knight ending is lost. I don't think it's that clear. Lackey Lannister, Crusader of Hope. Would you say it's a good idea to start studying one kind of opening, the theory behind it, and just see where that leads? I would say it's not a bad place to start. I mean, you need to have some kind of basic opening system. Especially with white. So it's not going to hurt you. I mean, I don't think the opening is something I'm going to stress as a chess teacher too much. But it's not going to hurt you, I mean, to study opening theory of one opening. You need to have some kind of basic setup. I think simplistic setups like the London system, some kind of closed queen pawn game, or one simple e4 opening is enough. That's where I would start with white and learning either e4 or d4. Don't learn a really hyper modern thing like the English first. Really stick with e4 or d4. I would say e4 probably, because you want to play e4 to develop like your tactical play. Calculation and stuff is easier to develop with e4 than d4. d4 leads to more closed positions. So I think for starting out players, the classical recommendation of e4, learning a simple repertoire with e4 would be the best place to start. Status troll took a while thinking about the position there, but it's good because you want to get this chess line 60 position straight in your head. And okay, so we could castle, but there's a bishop on d1. You can't castle with the bishop on d1. So if I want to castle queenside, I want to move that bishop out. Consider a move like e3. e4. But e4 starts to look like a closed Sicilian, where my strong point is on e4. And I'm not sure if I want to castle queenside in that kind of structure. It's going to take a while if I want to castle kingside here. I'm just kind of talking, and we'll retain some flexibility with the move d3. We could still opt for either e3 or e4, depending on what happens. This doesn't look like a setup where either side can really like launch an offensive type attack very quickly. Hard for both sides to mobilize the pieces here. Heavy pieces are far from the center. The bishops are kind of stuck in the middle, where ironically they have a hard time. A little bit of a hard time getting the long diagonals. What do you call the game where you get to place pieces on the board? Yeah, so like, well, crazy house or bug house. I'm not a big expert on any kind of chess variants, but a lot of people on lichess are actually. Lichess has great functionality with playing chess variants, so more so than most chess sites. Knight to c6. My extent of a variant play really was a lot of games like Bug House played with the team I coached. I used to coach a high school chess team back in the day, and those guys were really into playing the Bug House, so sometimes I had to bust out the Bug House skills, but not too much for me. It's been years since I played any Bug House. I guess I'm a competent player because I'm a good chess player, but not really expert. Probably not bad for your game to play Bug House, as long as it's not all you focus on too much. Probably hurts your chess if you play more Bug House than chess. Knight to e6. I'm gonna get my knight in the game. A very hyper modern type of setup here. I'm thinking of turning it into a kind of King's Indian while losing my voice. So I may go to play chess this afternoon, guys. I don't know. I'm thinking about going to this rapid tournament at the first Saturday. But sometimes the tournaments are really weak, first of all, and secondly, they move the tournament far away from this, a little bit far from the center in Budapest. So I'm kind of like, do I really want to like take a bus to go to this chess tournament? But I haven't played since June in an organized tournament, which is a really long time. It's a rated, FIDE-rated rapid tournament. Sometimes there's some good players, and you don't really know until you show up. Sometimes it's very, very weak. Sometimes there's even a GM or some IMs. So you never really know what you're going to get till you get there. But normally Friday night is my poker night. I play home game poker. But this week it was canceled, unfortunately. So we're looking for alternative things to do on Friday night. F5. Good move, why not? It's like staking out some space. And all along, I've basically been preparing this e3. Pretty quiet, but we're going to develop the bishop to the long diagonal, like a finiketto. We've got a problem with the bishop on e1, obviously. That piece is going to have to get into the game. And Lasker, was it Lasker? I always ask this question. I think it was Lasker who said the pieces that are having trouble getting into the game, but get in the game. When they finally get in the game, they come out very, very strong because they're angry. They're like angry pieces. This piece is an angry piece on e1. So if he does get in the game, and it's usually true, this kind of folksy sort of saying, but the angry pieces do come in the game rather effectively in most cases. Three-player chess is actually a thing. We always play Bug House after our game at the club with a beer. Nice way to relax. I saw there was a post on lichess, actually. The lichess coders met in Paris and they put up some pictures from a bug house session at the cafe. If I ever get to Paris again, I used to play for a French chess team, but that was years ago. If I get to Paris again, I'll meet up with the lichess programmers, play some bug house. Bishop f3. So this is the plan, just to nail down this whole diagonal, which isn't a bad thing. But Satestrol has some control, some space with f5. I thought maybe g5, maybe he goes with the full g5 here. And so the game ends up turning into this thing where I'm kind of queenside control focused. Kind of like an English opening where I didn't play c4. The same principle. We're controlling kind of on the queen side. Now I could play knight to c4. That's a little double-edged because he's setting up now to potentially play b5 at some point. He has to watch out though because his knight is on the hit list. My favorite square is available, b3. I often talk about this knight 3 square. In terms of scriptive notation, this is like rook 3, knight 3, bishop 3, queen 3, etc. So b3 or the knight 3 square is usually not a great square for knights. It's not in the center enough to have a great effect on the board. I don't know what I want to do. I could castle now just to better mobilize my rook toward the center, but I don't see myself getting in d4 necessarily anytime soon. Knight c4. Knight c4 b5 kind of seems a little scary to me. I could play knight d5. Just occupy Wall Street. Occupy d5 and try to follow up with knight c4. I need to think about this guy. I'm gonna play knight b3. I'm not thrilled about this move, but it thinking about this guy on e1, I mean, he really needs to get into the game. A good book for slightly more advanced players is Chess for Zebras by Jonathan Rowson, and not a book for absolute beginners. It's he talks about talking to his pieces. So I was joking yesterday if I'm like being discriminatory by calling my pieces guys. But this player here, this bishop on e1, wants to get into the game. And talking to your pieces, I think you just have conversations with yourself silently, hopefully, while you're playing. It's a really good way to approach analyzing. I use it a lot in chess and poker. Don't start doing it out loud. People around you will think that you're crazy. Have you committed to a mental institution? How do you start? Oh, okay, how do you decide to start over the board? Buckhouse, roll a die. Good question from Lackey Lannister. There was something about that, in fact. I've never been to an over the board chess 960 tournament. Maybe they have them at like chess festivals, like Pardubice in the Chess Republic. We could call it the Chess Republic. Kalmykia is the Chess Republic, right? Chess and alien abduction. Knight to b3. No, actually, I think when the president of the Chess Federation, Kirsan, was abducted, it wasn't from Kalmykia. He was in Russia, in Moscow. I mean, he claims to have been abducted from Moscow. I just got confused there. The Czech Republic is, I'm just rambling. The Czech Republic is host to a summer tournament series where they have a lot of events, and I'm sure that like Chess 960 is among them. Yeah, rolling a die might be one of the ways they determine the starting position. Satestrol's big enemy here is the clock, as always. He needs to trust his instincts a little bit more and just go for it. my opinion. Saddest troll you have. I never asked you really about this, but you have down for your location. What is it? I can't stay on that. Why wouldn't it let me? So, you have Nepal down as your location, is that correct? So a lot of people, I never asked you, but a lot of people just put random stuff down, but I kind of assumed that you really were in Nepal. Maybe you're a lunatic. I don't think so, man. You have a space advantage on the king side, and it's not the most fluid move. Obviously, I can play h4. I don't think it's a lunatic. I think this is a sound positional move. I mean, much more usual to play like g5 here. Probably slightly more fluid. Then again, there's a risk I could do something like g4, try to undermine your white squares. I don't think h5 is lunatic at all. I mean, I think it makes complete sense. You have more space on the side of the board. You're playing the king side, I'm playing on the queen side. If I play h4, you play g5, and if you can get an h4 yourself, then this whole issue of having an isolated pawn will go by the wayside, basically. So, kind of like the bayonet King's Indian, where black plays like a5 and white plays bishop a3, and then there's like a takes b, bishop takes b3. White has this isolated pawn on the a file, but as long as I can play a4, a5, it doesn't matter that I isolated my pawn because I'm going to just trade it off by force. Same thing applies here. If I play h4, you play g5, and you play and I isolate your h pawn. It wouldn't matter that this is isolated if you can trade it off. Let's see. It's in Italian, but you don't need to understand the commentary. What is that? What's that? Michelle BR? What do you think of SCAP in English? I don't know what that is. What does it stand for? You need to calculate two move variants to get to candidate master style level. The right two ones. I'm not sure what that is. Somebody clue me in. Maybe knight d5 now. Since we're on this bishop. It's turning into a very weird English opening. If I play c4. Oh, king d8. Wow. It's such a close position, you might get away with that. But I don't really trust that king position. Now you can't castle. It's such a strong knight. I don't know if I even want to take. So, c4. The one drawback of c4, it might give him b5 at some point. Chipping away at my pawn structure, kind of bringing his guy into play. Guy. I'm gonna castle queenside. Almost all my pieces are developed, and my pieces are pretty harmonious. Even the knight on b3, not really well placed, but it controls c5. It discourages a5 a little bit, so it has some kind of influence in the game. I could take on e7, and certainly that's reasonable. Queen h6. Now king b1 or bishop d2. Not sure I want to commit my bishop to d2. Maybe I can get it to c3 where it's more active. And now we could win material with knight takes e7. I'm not sure I want to go to that extreme. In order to win material, I have to play like knight takes e7, king takes e7, bishop takes c6, pawn takes c6. Which gives up my white squared bishop and quite a bit of control of the position, I would think. Although c4 b5 also disturbs me a little bit. C4 b5. No good discovery for me. It'd be knight takes c7. It is a little risky. I mean, to leave his knight unprotected there on c6. I could play something like knight takes c7 if he plays. a b5 in this position. Knight a5, knight takes e7. I'm getting low on time too. I decided to take that guy off. He wanted to play bishop c6 and trade. Oh, this, all right, this is a pawn now. We are taking this pawn. This is a clear pawn, and there's no concrete counterplay. So we are accepting this gracious offer. Guys, we're streaming for another hour every day from Monday to Friday, basically. I don't know if I want to take another pawn here. It seems kind of greedy to try to take a second pawn. Let's put our king in a safe position on a1. We have a policy here on the stream as a player, as our style of play. Ooh, no cheapo there. Maybe I'll hang my queen. A style of play that's basically, we're going to try to be not too materialistic. That's my philosophy. So I'm not going out of my way to win material. I like to have the initiative. I'm not a materialist. Thanks for the game, Troll. I don't think you're a maniac for playing H5. I think that's totally, like, normal. And you were okay there. I think the play with your king was a little bit suspicious, though. Check, take, attack plan. Technique to organize your thinking as regards selecting moves. Interesting. Is there a particular author or exponent of this system who created it? Creator? Who is the creator? Why wasn't there a push of the D or E pawn, says Lackey Lannister? Just not necessary. It was a very hyper-modern type of opening. Okay, Potzer, that's me. New opponent. We're playing 5-5. It's sort of blitz with increment. C3 Sicilian. Always a pleasure. Not really. I'm just kidding. I hate playing against C3 Sicilian. One of my worst openings statistically, if you do a chess base, whatever survey of my games, probably the C3 Sicilian is like number one. For me, in terms of bad statistical results, I've tried to play everything against the C3 Sicilian without a lot of success in my career, so I can't remember winning too many games. I played this against Sveshnikov himself. Knight A3, the hyper early Knight A3 line. Long time ago in New York, there was a big GMA tournament, Rapid Chess. Played with the legendary Yevgeny Sveshnikov. He won against me a nice game with knight a3 and knight b5 and all the standard stuff. That time I was pretty inexperienced. Here now, I'm thinking black can even play queen d8. I'll voluntarily play queen d8. Although a6 is another line. Just stopping knight b5 and I guess there's some validity to that. It creates other weaknesses a little bit, b6, but it's a variation if I recall correctly. Now bishop e2 is very quiet. I think we want to develop the king side before it's too late. Potzer, that's me. He's got a minute on the clock already. That's why we stopped doing rated games, if anybody's wondering. It's a lot of effort to... takes a lot of effort to really commentate and talk about the games and play as well. So look at this guy, he's used no time for the entire game while I'm talking about the game. So I'm kind of handicapped. And with that sort of handicap, it's best not to play the rated games. People just try to take advantage of me. So Pastor, that's me. H3 is a strange move. Got the bishop on the long diagonal. I talk a lot about using your time. Michelle BR says, according to the video, Maker, this technique is the most used by players in long-time matches as it allows you to find impossible moves. Combinations in which you sacrifice material without compensation at first. So it sounds kind of interesting. I'll have to check it out. A little bit like a... Key one. Maybe I should have played pawn takes pawn there. So I think I missed the boat. Instead of bishop e7, pawn takes pawn, he can take with a knight, and if you take with the queen, I can play bishop takes a3. So it was a definite error. Now bishop f1 and white is, again, maybe still, I mean, pawn takes pawn and bishop takes a3 as a kind of positional concept here, best. I'm not sure. I really want to give up my bishop, but it looks like a pretty serious long-term structural weakness for white. Not just these a pawns, but this pawn as well. So white has some compensation, but kind of hard to pass up on this. Do I want to trade queens here? I really don't know. My queen is pretty well placed. Not sure I want to bring his knight to d4. Threatens to go to f5. Well, I could just trade and play. It seems perfectly normal to just trade and play castles. In any kind of endgames, normally, you want the king to be able to be in the center, but in this position, it's the fact that my dark squared bishop is gone from the position makes it impossible for me to leave my king on e7 or c7. In one of those squares, it would be just vulnerable to a lot of attacks. So we don't want to leave the king on e7. All right, now thinking positionally here, a little bit like if I was playing against a computer, I would be happy with this kind of game. Take the tactics out of the position. I also have knight c5. Possibly attacking the pawn on a4. But one fundamental thing you can do is take a position where the other side has two bishops like this and just play to trade the bishop pair off. You know, bishop c4, trading this bishop pair away. So it's now bishop and knight versus two knights. Usually that's the right plan 90% of the time when you've got a situation where the opponent has the bishop pair. It's usually the right plan to disarm the bishop pair as we are here. Now he's desperately sacrificing a pawn with a5, and I don't think it really makes a whole lot of difference, I want to say. So I'm going to take. B5 wouldn't really be better. And this is interesting because he has a little bit of idea of freeing the bishop on a3. So I kind of like the pawn sacrifice in spirit. But Pastor, that's me, or Potzer, tomato, tomato. Can we say it both ways? Is it really like tomato? We have to say Potzer. We want to be faithful to the original pronunciation. Maybe we have to say Potzer. Patzer. All right, well, we're winning another pawn now, and it's starting to look like that's pretty serious. Knight takes on the a4 pawn. Rook takes feels like it develops a piece. We're probably going to end up in an ending where we're up a pawn or two, which should be good enough. I wouldn't mind trading. Whoa, kind of scared me with that quick move. I was like, what is that? Rook c4. It's not a bad move. Although, no, it is a bad move because he's gonna attack. He's gonna potentially attack me. I feel like we need a plan here to attack something in White's position concretely. Maybe the a4 pawn. Start isolating weak targets like a4, f2. Other things are like goals for Black in this position. Maybe improve my king position. Eliminate the back rank weakness by moving my h pawn forward. H pawn or g pawn. So start to think of the position, how to play this better position. Now rook b1. It's like he's threatening to play rook b7. Could play knight to c5 here. Not sure that's a good move. Maybe I should wait, play h5 first. Gain some space. He's making pretty random moves. King g1 now. Away from the center. Kind of strange. Maybe knight c5 now. There's no more back rank problem. Can also attack his knight. Maybe just rook to d3. Not stable, not an outpost. I thought knight b3. Because now we have this move. A discovered attack on. I don't know if knight b3 would have helped though, would it? I guess knight b3 wouldn't have been any better. The same problem. So maybe White had to play rook d1 or something there. But Patzer, that's me too fast. You know, take more time. And no need to play so quickly. Maybe you're not used to the 5-5 increment. If you get used to playing just 5-0 or 3-0, it's sometimes hard to adapt to challenging and playing with an increment. Talking while playing is surprisingly difficult. I didn't think it would be. Well, it's one thing to just talk and like, you know, I don't know how other streamers are. I know some of them are basically just talking a lot of shit while they play. That's one thing, you know. I mean, hey man, nice move. Yeah, I'm gonna crush you now. Okay, that's not what I'm doing, you know. I mean, anybody can do that. I can probably just talk shit while I play the game, and that's a normal blitz hustler kind of thing. But to really try to. It's one thing to just talk, but it's another thing to really try to incisively teach people what's happening in the game. That's a different story. So that's what I'm really trying to do. And it's very taxing, actually. I find myself very tired after the 2.5 hour stream. And I'm like, why am I so tired, you know? Because, like, just playing Blitz wouldn't have tired me out, you know, like that much. So it's really amazing. Takes a lot of energy for me to do the stream and actually commentate, you know, with a really meaningful sort of talk. Akizius, another blitz type game, new player here. Interesting opening. So he's playing kind of Chigorin with bishop f5. I'm not sure if I have anything better here than knight c3. And this position, yeah, after e6. He's got threats of knight b4. You have to watch out for that. That actually is a serious business. Sometimes it's dangerous to even like take pawns on b7 in such positions. So I don't know the theory with this. Queen a4 is kind of interesting. What if I played a neutral move like g3? You know, would this be a serious problem, perhaps? So e3, knight b4, and then I have to like sacrifice a pawn with e4. I think I've seen that happen before. Maybe even playable for white. But is there an easier way to deal with this? Yes, most likely there is. Just that outside the pawn chain, where do I put my bishop? Bishop g5. So I'm talking a lot here and not really leaving myself with a lot of time. But I'm interested in this position from a sort of theoretical standpoint. Not sure I want to play the correct move, but I'm really not sure what it is. I don't have it committed to memory. This is a fairly rare position. Bishop f4, maybe, okay. I could transpose to a bishop f4 type of variation in this line. Gives us rook c1. Bishop f4 against the Chigorin is a solid variation played even by, for example, like Anatoly Karpov. But I know that there's a more incisive way for me to play that position. And now he's created tactical possibilities for white. Queen a4. B6. Hard to understand why you need to play b6, or what the purpose of b6 is. I try to teach people that it's very important that every move you play in the opening, you really try to have a concrete idea. What is the purpose of this move? Knight takes d5. So every single move you play, you should really try to play the best move. That's my philosophy. It's worked for me. There are players who are more practical, I suppose. The only chance there for black is to play bishop takes bishop. And obviously white is better. Maybe I'm winning. Bishop takes bishop, h takes g. Yeah, and then he can't defend against the threat of bishop b5. So b6 really a kind of almost fatal waste of time. No reason to play b6. I mean, sometimes in this type of variation, I play queen b3 and your b pawn is attacked, but here b6 was just a totally random move. Sorochi said, I asked the next one on your list, Aprili, to change the challenge twice in the chat from 8-0 to 8-3. I guess he's not here, or maybe the word of the master himself counts more. You don't count, man. Yeah, Aprili, I'm sorry, I should pay more attention. Well, Aprili looks like a new player on lichess. He probably just doesn't know what's up. So bishop b4 check. Yeah, that would be nice if I took and you took and I took on d7, you got your piece back, but you could play simply knight to d2. That looks like the cleanest, not losing my right to castle. Losing my right to castle no matter what. What am I talking about? Well then king e2. Maybe I like king e2 even better. If we're going to lose our right to castle no matter what, then we're going to just bring these pieces to the center. So, yeah, Aprili, please re-challenge to 8-3 with an increment. Well, I'm just not going to accept the challenge until he'll realize maybe when I don't accept his challenge that there's something going on. So, Aprili, you can keep your place in line, but just re-challenge me to 8-3, so there's some increment. A lot of strong players at the end of the list here. Lonely Master. We haven't seen Theoretical Battle for a while. It's been away for a couple days. Right. Kind of only move. I mean, you can castle, but we win a piece. He's at least protecting his bishop on b4, but it's too late now. This is lost. Okay, you know, b6. Got plenty of time there. Lonely Master is a strong player. Yesterday he gave me for giving take back, so he's a true gentleman. He's got white. Last time, I think, was a King's Indian? No, a Dutch. We played a Dutch on Wednesday. I do a new thing where, for the past 3 weeks, we played unusual openings on Wednesday. I now call it Weird Wednesday. Playing openings I wouldn't normally play, just for fun and for learning purposes. So d4, knight f6. Last time, Lonely Master played an interesting line against me in a King's Indian. Fianchetto variation that I looked up later on, and I realized that, as I suspected, the variation he played was kind of prepared. For some reason, the variation I didn't really study very much. Maybe just because the players I prepared for usually played a different way. And played a lot of round-robin tournaments in the last 10 years. So Lonely Master plays a Trompowski, which is great, because it's something we don't get very often here on the stream. And I have a system I like to play with d5. And you can play what you want there. I mean, there are lots of good moves against the Trompowski. You can play c5, e6, d5, even knight e4. Although knight e4, I feel, is kind of risky. Knight e4, arguably, kind of the most trendy line, but it's sort of gone out of fashion now because people realize, like, knight e4 is not really a developing move, you know, and I'm not sure. It feels very aggressive to play it. I'm not sure it's better than the more stable kind of moves. But c5, you can argue that c5 is more dynamic than d5. If we look at the position after move 2, this is technically more aggressive than playing d5. D5 is a little more solid. Right, yeah, Lonely Master says he's 2308 FIDE, and I believe it. I mean, playing with him, he's pretty knowledgeable in the opening, and he also has a good endgame technique, which isn't really something that's typical for someone under 2300. So I think he's probably telling the truth about his rating, which is cool, because it's good to have some strong players here. We have had other strong players, 2300 is very, very good. Knight f3, and this is a situation where I have to be a little bit careful. It's tempting to play very aggressively with, like, queen b6. But if queen b6, white can maybe play a gambit type of Varisov, similar to what we saw last game. The exact same type of thing, like queen b6, knight c3, queen takes b2, knight b5, and it's scary and kind of unclear. I'd rather play more solidly here. I don't recall if the theory says, like, knight e4. Maybe knight e4 is better here than in the first position because, you know, white doesn't have f3 type of ideas. But in general, I'm not a really big believer in this knight e4. If white plays, like, bishop f4, he still has a totally decent London system type position. So I'm just going to develop with knight c6. One other possibility I play sometimes is pawn takes pawn. And I did have maybe the same position against international master Jozo Pataki last year in the Hungarian team championship. It was a funny game where he just draw, you know, got a draw with white. You know, we're equally rated players. It wasn't that he was playing for a draw, the game just ended up equal and I offered a draw, but he never moved his bishop from or he, what happened was he like didn't exchange on f6 and he ended up playing like bishop f4 later on, I think. So it was kind of funny. It felt like a moral victory for me. If the white player is playing bishop g5, then not trading on f6 and regretting it so much that they bring the bishop back to f4, it just really feels like I said, like kind of moral victory. Okay, so now c3, a quiet move, threatening maybe to take on c5. And e6 is very passive for black. So we could take on d4. We can also play queen to b6. I guess queen to b6. Now there's no knight c3. Aprili changed his challenge now, so don't forget to play him next. I wonder what I would do without you. Thank you, Aprili. So you get to keep your place in the queue, basically. Queen b6 helps our commentary here to have the 3 second increment, so it's not just helps my retarded sort of mouse that doesn't want to function and just causes me to lose on time a lot. Queen b6 is bearing down on b2, defending c5, enabling me maybe to develop my queen's bishop. I don't want to play blitz with like 3 seconds left and sudden death. I'm very bad at that. We are going to get a new mouse, though. This mouse is dead. I think it has a few days left in it, but I will use the money that was donated to buy stuff for the stream, for new mouse, maybe new or just getting the computer tuned up. Okay, queen b3, now c4, and the position is very similar to like kind of London system, just that the bishop's on g5 instead of f4, which is maybe even good for me because he doesn't have this threat of going bishop c7 here. Now knight a3, and there is a threat of knight to b5 sometimes. Gladys Troll says you like the flag of Nepal. Oh, he's from Russia. Okay, he just likes the flag of Nepal. I didn't know because, you know, obviously you're in a time zone. I know that you're in a definitely in a time zone that's east of me. So, and you say comrades all the time, but I didn't know. You could be a Russian living in Nepal. Who knows? There's weirder things in the world. So knight a3. Rook a5 is a move in this kind of position. The other idea would be just to get my pieces developed. The bishop outside the pawn chain, perhaps. Feel like I'm leaning toward rook a5. I just don't like the knight getting on b5 because once it gets there, it's sometimes hard to get rid of it. Once I close the pawn center with c4, black has to be careful that ultimately he doesn't break that pawn structure up or that he doesn't get an e4, he or she. What was the last tournament you participated in? Did you place? Do you have serious aspirations for a GM title? I don't know how serious they are. I have dreams of still having a chance to get the GM title. If I could get back to where I was strength-wise, 10 years ago, I think I could do it. You know, I think if I could have done it, if I didn't get sidetracked by poker or make the decision to do poker for 5 or 6 years, I think I could have done it if I had stuck with chess full time. So I don't know, you know, maybe it's too late, maybe not. If I had $1 million in the bank and I could just travel to every single tournament, I think I could do it for sure. There's no doubt, you know, if I played unlimited, I'm 100% sure I could get the GM title, barring an illness or something. But with limited financial resources, not being able to play every single tournament that comes along, yeah, I don't know. You know, it's more than a dream, but it's not going to be easy. So Bishop F4, barring a page from the old Jozo Pataki here, Bishop F4, losing a tempo basically. He may be like a tempo down in a Bishop F4 London system line now, come to think of it. I guess if I have to play Rook A6, I could do that. We also have Bishop, we have Knight D7, so maybe I'm f just fine here. Bishop F5. Need to get the bishop outside the pawn chain, it feels like. Bishop G4. Maybe Bishop G4. Is it better Bishop F5 or Bishop G4? Feels more aggressive to play Bishop G4. Doesn't make it a better move. We gotta make a decision though. I don't want it buried on C8 and having to play with the bishop blocked in the pawn chain the whole game. But it might turn out that Bishop F5 was better than Bishop G4. Play the rapid tournament near you though, even if the opponents are weaker, help you to get back in the zone. Yeah, that's kind of what I was thinking. The last one I played was a disaster, I think. Was it the last one or one of the last ones? I have not done well in the last couple, but I hadn't been streaming for that long. I guess I'm gonna chop this guy off here and play sensible moves. There's an interesting possibility now to play like Rook B5 in some positions. Played A3. And the idea is if I play B5, I guess he moves the rook and I can't play B4. I think still I probably should play B5. The pawn is always a weakness on B6, and it supports the C4 pawn from B5. Yeah, I think, believe me, Crusader of Hope, if this tournament was like where, you know, they normally had it, I would definitely go. It was in the center of the city, but it's been moved to a new location, which is really out of the center, and it's quite a distance from where I live, so I'm kind of hemming and hawing about going to the place. I want it to just be in my house where it's very accessible. Just kidding. So we've got all our pawns on the white squares. We've got no bad bishop. He's got a pair of doubled pawns. The king, you see, this kind of move, you know, master type move. I do have B4, don't I? B4. He doesn't have. I don't have it because he has the knight takes A1. Interesting. All right. Knight H5 is a possibility. Strategically, fortunately, there's just not enough time for this kind of position. It's very frustrating. I'm gonna copy him. I had that idea first to put my king on D2. Okay. Maybe Bishop D6. Knight H5 also perfectly okay. F5. f5 perhaps. Threatening some kind of f4 pawn sacrifices. He's a very solid player, and he's content to defend slightly worse position, as he did in a previous game against me two days ago, very well, and even with a low amount of time, he knows how to defend slightly worse position. So I'm going to need to really try to find a way to make progress here if I want to win this game. Knight on h5 now looks kind of like a lost soul. Heading back to the center, looking at e4. And now maybe we go back again to h5. Keeping an eye on f4. We may have pawn breaks with g5. Wow, this is a shocker. So he made a very risky move there. Now, bishop h6. I did not expect e4. Man, pawn takes pawn would undouble his pawns. G5. Man, G5 is really interesting. Now g5. F4 check. And I calculated I could win the exchange here. It may be worse than that. I don't know. Yeah, no, I mean, it should be a fork with a knight on g3, should win an exchange, and then white will be fighting for a draw. I have to get the rest of my pieces back in the game. Unfortunately, if pawn takes pawn there, I have bishop takes g5 check. So he can't afford to do that. He doesn't really have an in-between move, which he would really like to have there. This pawn takes pawn, with the idea of bishop h3 check in some lines. So it looks like we win an exchange, and black is better. Okay, now, I guess I don't have to do anything here, just recapture. Knight e3 here. I could get in b4 in some positions, but I think I have to play knight e7 first. This is kind of double-edged. Maybe king d6 is worth considering here. But anyway, knight e3 is a good move. Very good move. B4 maybe? Pawn takes pawn, not good. Knight e7. Alright. Need to get my rook back in the game. B4 is probably not going to work. Now b4 is interesting. Not interesting enough. Okay, now we need to take that rook. Get all my games. All my games and the pieces. All my pieces in the game. This knight g6, knight f4 would be good. He's defending well again. Man, maybe knight f5 here? I lost on time. God, I lost on time. Alright. I didn't know. I did it yesterday, too. Good game, man. So you hung in there. Black is better, but I don't know if I'm winning or not. It's close. Yesterday I froze in the headlights in one game too against Geese in a drawn rook and pawn ending. So that's a danger. I do flag lately. Occasionally if the position is very interesting, I lose touch. I thought I had more time than he did, but I did until the very end. Anyway, good game, Lonely Master. Interesting struggle there. Couldn't make the transition to playing 3 seconds of move. Just lost on time. In a July tournament, I played average 2375. Not really weaklings. Yeah, I finished minus swan. That was slight disappointment. But c'est la vie. I think I lost a couple rating points. 3 or 4 rating points, maybe. But not too bad, considering that I didn't play for 5 years in a real tournament. I did play one weekend tournament. I won the New England Open, which is like a 6-round weekend tournament back in like 2013. Maybe I played in a couple of those weekend-type tournaments, 2012, 2013. But I didn't play a serious 9-round tournament since at least 2011. Knight to c6 here, and white's thinking. So I flagged last game. Anyway, it was an interesting game. What do I mean people by flag? Yeah, the analog chess clocks have a flag on it that falls down. So if you learn chess on the internet, obviously you wouldn't understand what that means. Never really thought about that. Oh no, okay, I'm gonna play g6 because it seems like Alexander knows the white side of the classical Sicilian really, really well. We don't know who this player is. I mean, it's just a player I've played 8 games with now. But I haven't played this particular opening against this player. So I thought I'd try something different. Because they seem fairly competent against the classical Sicilian on the white side of the Richter Rouser. Now, white playing a very standard line that I also play. This is called the Marazzi, named after the famous Hungarian GM, Géza Marazzi. The pawn structure with c4 and e4. Gives white a large spatial advantage in the center and does make it hard for black to get an active game. Normally, black tries to play like a6 and b5 to break free in some variations of this sort of pawn structure, but what I'm doing here is a different plan. This with a5 is a kind of dark square blockading plan, and what we aim to do is to get very good control of the dark squares, maybe trade the dark squared bishop, get a kind of defensive lock on the position. There's a lot of theory in this variation. My move order is a bit unusual. As I said yesterday, it's kind of problematic in this line. If you play bishop d7, white can play knight to c2. So keeping the pieces on the board in a position where black has less space. So I've kind of been playing around with move orders that don't allow white to play knight c2 necessarily, to avoid knight c2 in positions where white keeps the extra pieces on the board, where black is kind of cramped. Thank you, Hissit Notes, for the quick answers to the questions and helping out here in the channel. Yeah, it's interesting that modern players just learning the game online wouldn't even have a clue what we're talking about. We say flag. Yeah, so the analog chess clocks, that's what you would say, flag. There is this crazy guy who did commentary with me on ICC for a while, years ago. National Master, FIDE Master Brian Wall. He would do practical jokes a lot. He likes to joke around. And he told a story. Actually, I was there when this happened. Not in the room, but like around when the incident took place. He had a funny thing he did against this Grandmaster, Michael Rode. Brian Wall, just, they were playing on an analog clock and hammering the clock. And both flags were hanging in intense time pressure in a rapid game. And Brian just, like, Rhodes' clock was just like 3 seconds from falling or something, and 5 seconds from falling. So both sides were checking to see if the flag was gonna fall. And Brian just, like, prematurely called him down. So he was like, flag! And it cost Rhode enough time to, like, look at the clock. And actually, he ended up, like, losing on time because he took the time to, like, look at the clock, because Brian called him down illegally, like, and there was a big scandal and people were screaming and Rhode was hysterical. It was kind of funny, actually. So eventually what happened was the tournament director ordered that the game be reset back to where it was when the time was was called, you know, illegally, and Brian still managed to, like, win on time. Somehow, I think, in the end. So it was kind of funny, but he avoided maiden one by one move. He was totally lost, but he had more time, and somehow he tricked Rhode into thinking he would play the obvious move, but played a different move, and Rhode just couldn't move the pieces fast enough, and lost on time, like, before giving mate, one move away from mate. So it was funny, but the days of the analog clock are unfortunately behind us. My friend, Grandmaster John Fedorovich, I mentioned this before, he always liked to play with the cheapest clock available. Increase the chance that someone would lose on time. Okay, now, wow, Alexandra here with Rook B1 seems to know all the theory in this variation. What an absolute madman. Yeah, he's a crazy guy. He was a crazy guy. He was basically, like, homeless for a long time when I met him in Boston. Like, living in the woods or something with his girlfriend. I don't know. He's a very strange, crazy person. He's back in Colorado. B3, Rook FC8. This is theory. Alexander playing the main line, knowing the theory pretty well here. Sophisticated theoretical knowledge. Most people don't know this variation. But then knight to d5. So knight to d5 nevertheless must be a move, but here rook c2 is the main line. If there's a funny trick, but after this move, if a3, black has knight takes b3, I think. If bishop takes b6, knight takes d2, and if queen moves, where could queen move, actually? Queen d3? Queen takes to e3. It's a great trick. a3, knight takes b3, queen d3, queen takes e3. Queen takes e3, bishop d4, skewers the queen to the king, and black gets away with the pawn advantage. So knight to d5. Critical moment. Do I take or play queen d8? I think I have to play queen d8 here. Looks passive to play queen d8. I could play queen d8, and then after bishop g5, what would I do? It looks very awkward. I end up having to play bishop takes d5 anyway, so. I swear that somebody else might have played this against me in the not-so-distant past. a3, knight takes b3. What about queen takes b2? You're just hanging your bishop on e3. That's the problem. You have to keep the e3 bishop protected. And that's one reason why you might see players from time to time, including myself, and Joseph Fang, who worked a lot with me in this variation. You see a lot of players from time to time play in this position, bishop f2, instead of bishop e3. It's possibly a better move order. So c takes d now, and queen b4 looks interesting. So let's calculate. Queen b4, queen takes b4, pawn takes b4. Rook c2. But then I guess I have bishop c3. I think I've played other moves in this position. Queen d8. Objectively, I'm not sure if queen b4 is best. Queen d8 is much safer. But knight d5 is not very common. Probably doesn't cause black the maximum discomfort. Keeping the tension in the position makes more sense because white has more space and you want to kind of strangle black slowly. I haven't played this in a not-so-distant future past. In the not-so-distant past, I think I played somebody who played knight to d5 against me. It's very vaguely familiar. Alexandra may have been disconnected. Mm-hmm. I have a suspicion about who this might be, Alexandra, but I'm not sure. Certainly wouldn't. This is actually the second time this has happened with WGM Alexandra. There was another game where they got disconnected and couldn't come back recently. I have my suspicions. So we'll give them like till their time runs out. I guess I should really give them till their time runs out, but we've only got time for like one more game, basically. They look like they might be back. If they were back, I would give her back some time. I'll give Alexandra a minute back if they do resume the game. Okay. Give her a minute back. Being the generous guy that I am. And now, so I'm thinking b5. You're going to trap my queen in lines here. But I think b5. I don't think you can trap my queen after b5. Although, yeah, I don't know. It's hard to trap the queen here. And, I mean, theoretically, I'm trying to play a4. So, I had to dodge threats of rook c4, and anyway, I want to get my pawns moving. White has a weakness on a2. This bishop is the question. The white squared bishop in the Marazzi, is it a good piece or is it a bad piece? If it takes this pawn for free, it's a good piece. Otherwise, it can be a bad piece because it's restricted by its own pawns. And many endgames are very difficult for white because of that. It doesn't hurt having a powerful dragon bishop unopposed here. Doesn't have any fancy trapping my queen with a3 or stuff like that, so. We have d4. There's never any trapping my queen with bishop. He basically can't attack my queen and control the d4 square at the same time, so I always have a place to go. She, he. But the one danger sometimes is that the white squares start to fall apart. Black has to be careful about that. Okay, so now rook c2 and a3 is not a threat. So we play a4. Pawn takes a4. Queen takes a4. And then this is the trick. This is a very subtle move, like protecting a2. And so enabling them to play rook here is one possibility. Maybe the other rook too. Kind of a pity though. Queen a3, not really. That could get trapped there. So rook c2, very subtle move, enabling a4. Pawn takes pawn, queen takes a4, bishop takes b5, because the a2 pawn is protected now. That is pretty insightful. Pretty deep idea by white. Rook b8, I guess. Overprotecting b5. Queen c1. Wow. That's okay. I have bishop d4, right? There's always something sneaky that black can do. This is the thematic exchange that I was trying to make a long time ago. Maybe King F2 there. King F1. Wow, that looks almost crazy. All right. Putting my pawns on the dark squares, and I was a little afraid of queen b2 actually trading queens in that position. So I'm kind of glad that this move, though, I'm not sure about. Queen g7, maybe queen e5. Queen e5, f4. Queen g7, queen f6. What about queen f6? White is going to triple on the file. Looks like black has good chances on the dark squares. play a4. If this move does anything, b3, not really. Now b3. Not sure about it. Wow. Jeez. I'm not sure what's going on here. This is a really strange position. Lost a pawn here. It's pretty bad. Amazing defense by white. Still, it's hard with the knight queen combination. I might be able to play knight g6 and queen a1, but very good defense. Okay, guys, that's going to wrap it up for today. Sloppy play by both sides at the end there. Not a lot of time to find the best move, but it was an interesting struggle. So, kind of like the game I I lost on time. Rook d3, rook takes d1, just deflection from b2 possible. There was a rook d3. Oh. Of course. So, yeah, I missed the forced win there. I played knight d3. It was the wrong piece. Yeah. Thank you, Hisidna. So that's obviously winning. Rook d3. Wrong piece. I played the d3. Anyway, it usually gets a little sloppy. There's this simple rook takes d1 and queen takes b2 combination. Didn't see it. So, as usual, my blitz technique, not always the best. But anyway, I'd like to thank you guys for joining me. I'm going to be back on Sunday with a simul here on lichess. It will be 6 p.m., possibly 6:30 p.m. I'll keep you updated. Maybe 6:30 is better. 6:30 p.m. on Sunday, between 6 and 6:30 on Sunday, CEST. 20, maximum 25 players, simul here on lichess. White was much better after queen b4, a4, stopping b5. This line is very suspect for black. This line, like the whole opening, you mean? Perhaps so. I don't think so, theoretically, but maybe that position wasn't correct. Queen b4, a4, stopping b5. I don't know about that, but normally white doesn't want to put the pawns on white squares. Anyway, we'll talk to you guys later, and thanks for joining us. Saronchi, thanks for moderating. We'll see you guys soon. Bye-bye.